today we're going to be talking about, this is actually chapter 26. Sorry, this is about emergency and critical care nursing. We're going to be focusing in this chapter, it's a really long chapter, but for introduction, we're going to talk about some basic stuff about CPCR, which is cardiopulmonary cranial resuscitation, and how do we assess patients that might need help, about your crash cart, and about how to triage patients. Again, we've got our learning objectives. Feel free to go through those to make sure you know what you need to know. Small animal triage. Let's start with that. Very often when you start in a veterinary clinic, you get an emergency call. You're not sure what to do. So first of all, please get their name and phone number. First thing we need to find out, are they in respiratory distress? Respiratory oxygen is the first thing that we need. We can live for 3 minutes only without oxygen. If we have life-threatening bleeding, we need to stop that. We have the pressure on that. We need to know about that. And then if you can give a little bit of first aid based advice so that they can get to the clinic, we don't want to give them first aid advice to keep them away from the clinic. We want them to come to the clinic so we can actually see what's going on. We don't want to delay anything if they're critically ill. So we have to have some sort of way to get this brief history. Very often this is somebody who is going to be very stressed out, but you need to know their name and phone number so that if anything happens, you can give them a call back. Try to calm them down. Understand what the emergency is. Is it trauma? Is it collapse? Is it respiratory distress? Are they bleeding? Let's see them immediately. At that point, then we can ask more questions. First of all, we need to get them in. We can ask the signalment of the pet, ask the past medical history if that has any bearing on what we're going to be giving them or how we see this pet, what the onset of the clinical signs were, and you know, if it's not obviously immediately a trauma or something, then we can, if we can step back and ask some of those questions, sometimes we still need to see them immediately. But we can find this out as we ask more questions. So if we're looking at this, say we have to triage this board. So we have Tiger, Shadow, and Spot, and they're all here at the same time. We have somebody who has an abscess. We have somebody in respiratory distress. And we have somebody who's been vomiting for 3 days. So which one is first? Well, if you take a look at this, obviously our first thing is respiratory distress. If we have an animal that is unable to keep oxygen in their body and to their tissues, that is an emergency. After that, we look at these two things. An abscess, if it's been an abscess, if it's in a place that's not causing them respiratory distress or to bleed out or severe discomfort, abscesses are usually have been in place for at least 3 days, and we have this pet that's been vomiting for 3 days. Now, this pet that's been vomiting for 3 days may be violently ill, may be dehydrated. We may need to see that pet before we see the abscess. But first of all, we have to see that pet in respiratory distress. So we're going to do our in-hospital triage. Initially, we're going to sort the patients into three groups, one, two, or three, okay? To do that, we need a brief history, a quick physical exam, and very targeted discussion with the owners. Our initial triage exam is going to be 1 to 2 minutes. Are they breathing, bleeding, dehydration, or pain? And then we're going to get into a systematic evaluation of essential organ systems. Secondary examination is going to happen after the patient has been stabilized and or is fully registered. So immediate triage category priority one, we might color it red. That means we have chest wounds, shock, open fractures, burns, more than one burn. If it's priority two, it's delayed, we're yellow, they're stable, there may be it's a stable abdominal wound, it's not bleeding. We may have an eye or a nervous system injury. Priority three is minimal, green, that means minor burns, minor fractures, minor bleeding. Expectant or four is black, that means we have an animal that is unresponsive, maybe dead, or has a high spinal cord injury. There's not much we can do in the short term to stabilize this pet. Initial diagnostics. Here are some things that we can do, and you should understand these terms at this point. A packed cell volume is going to tell you how many red blood cells are swimming around in the bloodstream. total protein. If we take total protein along with packed cell volume, if they are both decreased, that means that we have bleeding somewhere. If we have a low packed cell volume but a high total protein, that means we probably have anemia somewhere. So, or anemia, not enough red blood cells being made, or it's being lost somehow. So we need to take those two things together. Blood glucose, blood gas analysis, blood pressure, those are all going to tell us something. Pulse oximetry is what we show here. Just having a basic idea of how much oxygen is in the bloodstream. An ECG, and then a fast ultrasound scan. A fast ultrasound scan is when we're looking at the abdomen really quickly, but we're looking at very specific structures. We're looking at the liver, we're looking at the spleen, we're doing looking at the bladder. We're doing a very quick sweep of the abdomen. Basic first aid, we're going to do that after a more detailed physical examination. We're going to look at the spine, do a complete neurologic exam, look at the head, eyes, pupils, full cranial nerve examination, oral cavity, ears. Some of this stuff I'll be teaching you how to do later. The wounds will need to be clipped. They'll need to be cleaned and flushed with sterile saline and then bandages applied. Limbs need to be palpated. Make sure there's no open fractures. Make sure that there are no fractures. We may need to apply some splints. Splints will help to keep, if we have any fractures or luxated joints, will keep the animal from being in further pain. Using pain control or sedatives with the doctor's order to make sure the pet is doing okay, and then, of course, fluid therapy. In our emergency care station, we should have it easily accessible. It should be clean. It should be well stocked. The equipment, it needs to be organized and labeled. We need to have an oxygen source nearby. We need to have suction apparatus and a crash cart. Crash cart is going to have the items in it that you need if you're performing CPR or life-saving procedures, and it's all in one place. Let's look at this picture here and see what we see. Okay, we have this animal on a treatment table. Here we have a suction device that we can use. We have a crash cart here underneath, and this is a defibrillator, and underneath are drawers, and there are likely emergency drugs, IV catheter materials, tourniquets, other things we might need. This animal, there is probably a clipper thing, or the clippers actually right here. We have fluids that we can hang up here if we need to give fluids really quickly. So everything in one place, easily accessible. The crash cart needs to be restocked after every surgery, or after every emergency, excuse me, and should be inventoried weekly. In it, we need emergency medications, we need needles, we need syringes, we need a laryngoscope to look in the mouth, we need endotracheal tubes, we need an AmbuBag, we need instrument packs, we need red rubber catheters, a large bore IV catheter, we need to get those things in quickly. We need to discuss disorders of the respiratory system that we see in, or we're going to be discussing the disorders of the respiratory system we're going to see in critically ill patients in this next one, and talk about CPR and this common emergencies that we see. So when I said the respiratory system is very important. We need to make sure that they're breathing. That's the first thing we need to ask, okay? So we need to look at that respiratory effort and pattern, okay? Are they breathing hard? Are they really moving their chest when they're breathing? Or are they breathing shallowly because it's too painful or they can't expand their chest? What's their mucous membrane color? Look at their gums, look at their eyes, look at their ears. Do a pulse oximetry if you can. Do capnography. If you have a tube in their throat, you're going to measure how they're ventilating by measuring the carbon dioxide that comes out of them. Doing an arterial blood gas, getting blood from their artery and measuring that to know what actual oxygen and carbon dioxide is in the blood. And then putting them on oxygen support right away. If we have an animal that has stopped breathing or has stopped, their heart has stopped, and those two things don't necessarily happen at the same time, we need to resuscitate them. And our goal is to resuscitate their brain as quickly as possible. So we want to get oxygen to the brain as quickly as possible. That's why we call it now cardiopulmonary cerebral resuscitation, cranial resuscitation, CPCR. we need to get that that happening. Now, one thing we have to remember is that sometimes animals that are just vomiting will go into a CPR event where they'll have a CPA or a cardiopulmonary arrest because their vagal nerve, which is a cranial nerve that runs from their cranium, their head, all the way through their abdomen, is stimulated, and that's called a vagally mediated arrest. It slows the heart rate to the point of nearly stopping or actually stopping. So we have to keep that in mind even with vomiting animals. Performing basic life support for these CPR animals, it starts with chest compressions, and we do it differently based on the shape of the animal and the size of the animal. Chest compressions come first, and then ventilation. So we first need to feel the pulse and see if we have a pulse, and if we do not have a pulse, we need to do chest compressions. We are not as worried about ventilation as moving the blood around the body. Then, once we have the chest compressions going, then we will start the ventilation. If we can get a tube in the throat, that's the best way, with an AmbuBag, or bagging the pet, manually ventilating the pet is the best way to get ventilation in with pure oxygen. However, we can also do nose-to-mouth or mouth-to-nose ventilation as well. So those are our two options typically with animals. Advanced life support includes medications. So there are certain medications that will help support the heart to start beating or help it beat better. We can use defibrillation in certain cases where we actually have those defibrillator paddles that we put on the chest and shock the heart back into working. Open chest procedures are done in some cases, but they are not as commonly done in animals and probably should not be done in humans. By the time you get to an open chest procedure, your chances of actually bringing that animal back is less than 0.1. It's less than 1% for sure. Even with CPR, your chances of bringing an animal back is less than 3%. Basic life support for animals starts with the chest compressions. We're going to use a cardiac pump method with cats and small dogs, which means that we put our fingers on either side of the chest and compress the chest. We've got to make sure that you're compressing it enough to compress the heart. For cats and small dogs, it's 120 to 130 per minute. For medium to large dogs, it's 100 per minute. We can monitor how effectively we are pressing on the chest by doing a Doppler blood pressure probe, which will tell us if we're making a pulse, which means we're moving blood through. We can also monitor our effectiveness of ventilation with end-tidal carbon dioxide monitor, which we talk about with anesthesia in a couple of lectures, but we'll talk more about that. You can interpose abdominal compressions, and the reason we do that, especially for larger animals, is that when we press blood through the heart, then we need to get the blood through the rest of the body. And so if we press on the abdomen as well, we can get press on the heart, and then the abdomen, and then the heart, and then the abdomen. We can move more like a pump. We can move blood through the body. Open chest CPR, like I said, is not routinely done. Usually at that point, the animal's not going to survive. Intubation we can do with an endotracheal tube. If we cannot get access to the mouth or if there's a blockage, we can use a tracheostomy tube and do an emergency tracheostomy directly through the throat. We use ventilatory support with an AmbuBag or an anesthetic machine. And then acupuncture, this is strange but true, but acupuncture, it can be helpful in stimulating respiration, in some cases more helpful than medication. What we do is there is an acupuncture point just below the nose, right at the junction of the nose and where the gums start at the mouth. I will try to show you in a real-time web camera. If you touch just below your nose, you will feel just at the top of your gums. You can do this over your skin, over your lips. You don't have to go into your mouth. You can feel a little divot there. And if we go into that divot with a little needle and we rotate that needle, we can actually stimulate them to take a breath. And this is something we will use with little bitty C-section kittens or puppies to stimulate them to breathe, and it works fantastically. So advanced life support, when we have to move to advanced life support, what we're looking at is the EKG, and there are three main arrest rhythms. So when we're looking at an EKG and we see a flat line, that is called asystole. Asystole is the flat line. We can also see electrical activity, so the line will be moving, but it will be pulseless. So we call that pulseless electrical activity. That means you cannot feel a pulse, but there's still electrical activity going through the heart. The last thing that we see is ventricular fibrillation. It's often preceded by ventricular tachycardia. That means that the QRS part, that bigger part of the EKG that we look at, is spiking really quickly. Tachycardia means fast heart rate. So we see that big spike very, very quickly, and then it will start to flutter. Once it starts to flutter, we lose electrical activity through the heart. It gets really confused, and it just gives up. And so then we get asystole. So we do not want to see ventricular tachycardia, because then it leads to ventricular fibrillation, and then you get asystole. That's a flat line. If we see ventricular fibrillation, that's the point at which we can do defibrillation. So that's the point at which we can shock the heart back into a regular rhythm. So if we miss that point, it's very difficult to get an animal that is flatlined actually back to a regular heart rhythm. Drugs that we can use during these events, we can use them intravenously. We can go through an intraosseous catheter. We can actually go through the endotracheal tube. And there are only certain drugs that will work this way, and they start with the first letters of their name start with NAVEL. So if you remember navel, you can remember some of these drugs, and we'll go over those. I believe I have those in the next slide. Intracardiac injections are not routinely done anymore because it's really easy to make a mistake with that one. But some people still do those. So we do try to get it IV. If not that, we'll try to get it endotracheally. Those are the quickest ways to get things in. When we're dealing with an owner that it has an animal that is undergoing CPR, we do need to present them with realistic expectations. When we're doing CPR, like I said, 97% of the time, they're going to die. We want to know ahead of time if they want us to try to resuscitate or not. It's an expensive process. You have three or four people working on this animal for an extended period of time. We're using major drugs. We're using major equipment. It can be an expensive process. So I guess I don't have my navel drugs there, but atropine, vasopressin, epinephrine, lidocaine, and I'm trying to think of the N, and I can't think of it at the moment, but I will think of that. But those are the major ones that we will do. I want to say it's some type of phenylephrine or something that we use to increase the heart rate, to open up blood vessels, to reestablish good rhythm, to establish the respiratory rate again. Those are the type of drugs that we use. Common toxicities and emergencies that we see, respiratory distress. Obviously, if we have respiratory distress, it is very anxiety-ridden. If you can't breathe, you feel like you're going to die, no matter if you're going to die or not, and then it will make things worse. So we want to minimize the stress. We want to give them oxygen. We may need to sedate them in order to minimize the stress. Trauma. So trauma happens. It could be falling out of a truck or getting run over by a car. We need to do a triage examination because it could be head injury, could be abdomen injury, could be something we can see, could be something we can't see. Need to get them under pain control. Once we have done our triage examination and controlled the pain as much as possible, we go to the secondary exam and then reassess continuously because there's a lot of stuff we can't see that we sometimes have to go back and take another look at. Acute abdomen, when they have a sudden onset abdominal pain, we have to know what's going on with that, so we need to get a complete history on that. One of the problems with acute abdomen is we can see a gastric dilatation volvulus, which is where the stomach twists, and when the stomach twists, it twists some major blood vessels, and it can kill the animal very quickly. So we can see an animal that has acutely upset abdominal pain, they have an acute abdomen, They'll be retching but not producing anything. They may be gasping for breath. They may be bloated, or you may not be able to see them as bloated. They may collapse on you. So we need to try to stabilize them as quickly as possible and then get them into surgery as quickly as possible. Now, when we get them into surgery, we often can, we do an exploratory, untwist the stomach. We may have to remove portions of intestine if they're dead portions of the intestine because blood flow hasn't been going on. And then what we'll want to do is take the stomach and tack it to the wall of the abdomen so it doesn't have an opportunity to twist again. Because if they twist once, they'll twist again. Another thing that's an emergency that we see a lot with cats is urethral obstruction, especially male cats. They may be straining to urinate, so the owner may think they're in the litter box a lot, but they're actually not urinating. And so if they do that for 2 or 3 days, by the time we see them, they're stuporous. They may be in hypovolemic shock. There certainly could be hyperkalemic. Hyperkalemia means they have too much potassium going around in their bloodstream, which actually is very dangerous for the heart. We need to sedate them and unobstruct them as quickly as possible. So we need to remove the urine from the bladder if we can. The best way to do this is to open up the urethra, usually with a urethral catheter. Toxin exposures, sometimes we don't know what they've gotten into. We need to ask a lot of questions. We need to decontaminate the animal. It may be that we induce emesis, which means we make them vomit. It may be that we stick a tube down their throat. We could sedate them or even not sedate them and just lavage their stomach out. It's a stomach pump. Then we often have to give them medication to bind toxins, etc. So we need to ask a lot of questions. We may have to make calls to the poison control. A lot of animals, when they come in, if we have an emergency, especially if they've collapsed, we want to get an EKG on them. So you need to know how to do an EKG. So we think smoke over fire. That's the best way to think about this. And that's on the left side. So you're left with smoke over fire. So smoke over fire means you have on the front limb, on the left side, you have the black electrode, and you have the red electrode on the lower limb. So up top is smoke, on the bottom is fire. On the right side, you mainly need to remember to get the white one on the right. White on the right. White on the right forelimb, white on the right. You're left with black smoke over fire, okay? The green one is always goes, it's your leftover one. It goes on the right hind limb, and that's basically kind of your control, okay? It's not always necessary to place that one, but just for symmetry's sake, we do put that on there. So always just remember, smoke over fire, you're left with smoke over fire, so that's going to be on the left side, and right, white is always right, which is not a comment, a racist comment. I'm just saying that that's the one way to remember it because we're rhyming there. Basic cardiac conduction and ECG waveforms. So this is what a normal waveform would look like. And anatomy is really important, and understanding anatomy is really important. And I'm just going to show you this, and you're going to remember it for later. But basically, we have a P wave. We should have a P wave for every QRS. And then we sometimes see a T wave and sometimes don't. And what's happening is this P wave is happening up here, and it's causing, as you see this, this is going along with a P wave here, atria of the heart. It's pumping blood down here. Then we have the ventricle, and it goes through here, and that's our QRS through the ventricles, and it's pumping blood out. So pump in, pump out, pump in, pump out. P wave, QRS, P wave, QRS, okay? So it's associated with each heart rhythm and rate. Each heart beat is associated with this QRS complex. So we have to have a P wave for every QRS. Now the way that they are put together, or if they're wider, or if they're shorter, or that will tell us what's happening with this heart. So four basic features that you're going to look at with an EKG: heart rate. The heart rate should be at a good rate. You should know normal heart rates for cats versus dogs, okay? So you should look at for heart rate. Heart rhythm. We should see a normal heart rhythm. It's going, your heart should be like with a normal rhythm. If it's not, if it's ba-dum, ba-bum, bum, 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 okay, that's not normal, and so that's going to cause a problem. So here we're seeing an animal with a, not a normal rhythm. We beat, beat, and then smaller beats that may not even be making, these are electrical activity that may not be making a beat, and then some really weird beats. These are QRS complexes where the ventricle is going, wait a minute, we forgot to beat. Now we're going to beat by ourselves. We don't have a P wave in front of us. And then it goes back to a regular rhythm. So you start to learn to see patterns and where the pattern is off. So this is a normal sinus rhythm here. So we're looking for heart rate, heart rhythm, making sure we have a P, Q, R, S, and T complex, and they're at certain intervals, and then looking at our mean electrical axis. That means how big are these waveforms? See, you can see these are normal, these are not normal. So what is our mean electrical axis? This electrical impulse is not getting where it needs to be. It's not causing a heartbeat. All right, so cardiac arrhythmias, there's a normal sinus rhythm, which is beat, 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 beat. A sinus arrhythmia can be normal. Sinus simply means that the beat originates from the atria, where it's supposed to. So it's originating from the top of the heart, and then it's pushing blood down into the ventricles, and then the ventricles push it out to the rest of the body. So sinus rhythm is normal. Occasionally, especially in dogs, a sinus arrhythmia is normal. This is what happens. As the dog breathes in, the lungs expand, and because the dog has a narrow chest, it presses on the heart, and the heart doesn't have as much room to beat, so it beats a little faster. So a sinus arrhythmia is normal if you're watching the animal breathe, and they breathe in, and the heart rate gets faster, and they breathe out and the heart rate slows down. So beep, 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 beep. That's a normal sinus arrhythmia. Sinus bradycardia is when you have normal P wave to QRS complexes, but they're slower than normal. A sinus tachycardia will be where you have normal P to QRS complexes, but they're faster than normal. Okay, so normal sinus rhythm, sinus arrhythmia, with dogs is normal. Sinus bradycardia means slow heart rate. Sinus tachycardia means fast heart rate. Okay, so now we're going to talk real quickly about equine emergency nursing. The most common thing we see with them is colic. Okay, anything wrong with their gastrointestinal system, and honestly, anything in their abdomen causes pain in the abdomen, which is colic. Respiratory system or respiratory distress, we may see that. And then musculoskeletal system, fractures and wounds. There's two potential waves of action with an emergency in equine. That's the field response, where we go, yep, we'll be there right away. And the second one is the referral. We can't get to you fast enough. Load them up, take them to the nearest referral office, or bring them straight into us. Colic, most common emergency, any condition causing abdominal pain. There are two categories. One is mild. It's going to resolve with minimal or no treatment. And then there's the second. Will not resolve with treatment and needs to go to surgery. All colics are potentially life-threatening, and all veterinary hospital staff must be prepared. With a colic examination, we're going to look at their pain level, and we can look at pain level based on their facial appearance, if they're able to pay attention to you, where their ears are, their attitude, their temperature, their pulse and the respiration, the mucous membrane color, their capillary refill time, and then, really importantly, their gastrointestinal motility. Remember, we need to use our stethoscope to listen to at least four different spots on their abdomen on each side to know if they have good motility through that abdomen. If at any point you're not hearing gastrointestinal motility or that borborygmus going through their intestines, that's a problem. Signs of pain can be kicking, their face could be really tense, their ears could be back, they could be rolling, they could be sweating, kicking at their abdomen. Those kind of things can indicate pain. Listen to their abdomen. If you're listening and you're flicking your abdomen and you hear what sounds like a basket, like you flicking at a basketball, something hollow, That may mean that we have a large amount of gas. And if you've ever had gas in your stomach that isn't coming out, you know how painful gas in the intestines are. It causes colic. So we want to get our blood work in, take a look at everything, make sure we're their systems are working okay. So here are some signs of pain: mild pain, pawing, stretching out, curled lip, standing quietly. Moderate pain would be that if we can sedate them and they go back to mild pain or no pain. Severe pain, they're throwing their head on the ground. You see sores on them. They're rolling. Sedation has no effect. If they were painful and are not painful anymore, you'll see these abrasions, or you might see dirt or hay or mud in the coat, signs that they were at some point rolling around on the ground. To do a complete colic workup, we're going to do a nasogastric intubation. That means we're going to put a tube into their nose, down their esophagus, and into their stomach. We want to know what's going on in their stomach and if we can get stuff out of their stomach, because sometimes the stuff that we get out of their stomach can be helpful. The other thing we want to do with that nasogastric tube is to infuse water fluids, which a lot of times they get dehydrated very quickly, and mineral oil. Because if there's anything stuck in the intestinal tract, sometimes just lubing it up with mineral oil will get that through. And sometimes a whole bottle, big gallon of mineral oil is what we need to infuse into that stomach. We can do an abdominal palpation per rectum, which means we get a big glove and lots of lube, and we put them in a safe place and stand behind them carefully and stick our hands up their rectum. And we can actually, if you know the anatomy, you can feel different parts of the intestine and really understand what's going on. We can do what's called a belly tap or an abdominocentesis, where we actually stick a needle into a cleaned part of the abdomen and see if there's any protein loss or anything in there that any fluid in there that would indicate that we have an issue. An abdominal ultrasound can give us an idea of if there's fluid in the abdomen or if we can actually see something that is not right. X-rays on small horses or foals might be helpful. And then last case scenario, if we need to do surgery, go to abdominal exploration. The respiratory tract, two categories of respiratory emergencies. Most commonly, we see an upper airway respiratory obstruction, and typically something they've gotten into or inflammation, and often we have to do a tracheostomy to open that up. Lower airway is often something that it's a lung disease or a failure to inflate their lungs if they have a chronic condition or if they've had trauma to their chest area. Musculoskeletal injuries, the second most common injury that we see or trauma that we see, emergency, second to colic, because horses are not the most calm animals. So they get fractures, lacerations, infections in the joint or soft tissue or within the foot, luxations. Some of these can be severe and life-threatening. I've been called to a farm before that a horse in the pasture fractured its lower limb, and we actually had to euthanize it. There was nothing else that we could do. Soft tissue injuries, usually it's on a distal limb. They kick at things. They get their legs caught in things. If there's loose metal or wire or wood or it's other horses being stupid, these can become life-threatening if they bleed out or if they become infected. So we want to do a general examination, make sure that we're looking at blood loss. They can lose a lot of blood. They can look like they're losing tons of blood and still be okay, but we do, because they're big animals. But we do want to watch and make sure that we're stopping that as quickly as possible. Sometimes if we have injuries that involve the joint, we need to do a joint tap that has to be done very sterilely. Generally, with any wounds, lacerations, abrasions, we can clean it with some antiseptic soap, rinse it with saline, try to decrease further contamination, debride any necrotic tissue, maybe have to suture things up, remove foreign material. We may have to, if we suture things up, we usually do it with standing sedation. So we'll just sedate them, keep them standing. It just really depends on how severe the injury is and what the temperament of the horse is. Putting them under general anesthesia is a big deal. If we need to, we can do x-rays. We do have a mobile x-ray unit. We ourselves, as a department, have a mobile x-ray unit. We can do these on the farm. We do not have ultrasound, but that is another way to get some ideas of what's happening if we have tendon or ligament injuries. with food animals, it's really important that you're going to anticipate each step when you go out to an emergency. Make sure that the patient is able to be restrained and that you're going to be safe. We need to consider that these are typically food animals, and so we do have to be careful any medication that we give them. So we're going to start with a general physical exam, heart rate, respiratory rate, temperature, lungs and hearts, and then, of course, the abdominal auscultation and percussion as well. Rectal palpation, again, is commonly done with these guys, especially with when we're dealing with a GI system. Anything else we can do, we can do abdominal ultrasound, abdominocentesis with belly tap, abdominal radiography, blood work. Those are things that we can do as well. So interestingly, with cows, we do a lot of standing surgeries with cows, major abdominal surgeries. So we could do it if we have a volvulus or of the abomasum or the cecum. So if they're twisted, we might do it if we have ulcers in the abomasum. We might do it if we have bloat in the tympani. We might have to have problems if we have like a vagal indigestion. If we need abdominal surgery, we can actually, this is an animal prepped for surgery. They're going to block this animal in the spinal nerves coming out of here will be blocked with local anesthetic. They may give her a pain relief of an epidural. They'll do a skin block right where the incision will be. And then this animal will stand there and chew her cud through surgery while they do the surgery. Specific conditions we might see as GI emergencies, diarrhea, because it can cause profound dehydration, hypovolemic shock, oral fluid, we'll need to give oral fluids and electrolytes. Often see that with calves. So I'll go out and see a really, really sick calf and have to give them fluids. Parasitism, Haemonchus contortus, remember I told you about Haemonchus contortus, that barber pole worm, are avid blood feeders and will cause profound anemia in sheep and goats, and they may need a blood transfusion. Rumen emergencies that we see, if they get bloated, it's called rumen tympani because it sounds like a big drum, with excessive gas accumulation because they have the wrong kind of bacteria in their rumen, we have to relieve that gas as quickly as possible. So we can stick this trocar, this big spike, we'll stick it through their abdomen on the outside and screw it in there and leave it stick in there and allow gas to escape. Or we can put this little mouth gag in and tie it around their head and put a tube in there and allow the gas to escape that way. These little guys, these monkey brains, Osage oranges, hedge apples, that's what they're called. The cows will eat anything. They can get an esophageal obstruction with these guys. We have to watch that to make sure that there aren't any near the pasture. To treat it, we may be able to massage it actually out of their esophagus, or we may have to place an esophageal tube and try to work it down with mineral oil into their rumen. Remember I said the rumen is really, really important. It's important that they have a normal rumen pH. We can test that. We need to make sure that they have the proper proper microbials, microbial growth in their rumen in order to process the food that they eat. So there are tests called the methylene blue reduction test. We can look at a microscopic examination. If we see a problem, somebody's not ruminating properly, we can do what's called a transfraunation. We're taking the ruminal microbes from a healthy animal, which this animal is obviously very, very healthy, nice and fat and happy, and this animal is used as a donor animal. She has had a hole permanently placed in her rumen. This is a permanent hole, and it is covered up usually with a flap, but if you are in vet school, you will have this animal there, and they will say, go get some, we need to transfaunate this other cow, this sick cow, go get some samples of the rumen material, and then you can strain it out and just get the good stuff and to give to the cow, and then you force feed it into the sick cow. Again, respiratory distress, it's another life-threatening condition, may need to do a tracheostomy. Coenal atresia, it's a congenital condition of alpaca crias. If they have no opening between their nose and their mouth, they cannot breathe. So you have to make an opening or do a tracheostomy because remember, they're obligate nasal breathers. Now, why alpaca crias? Because they are genetically not very different, and so we get a lot of problems with that. Orthopedic emergencies and downer animals. Large animals should not stay down for long periods of time. If they do, their limbs will not work. If their limbs do not work, they cannot live. So it is a big problem with large animals. We need to get them up and off of their limbs. And this is called a hip lifter. And see this animal, this cow, is being lifted by its bony hips with a pulley system. And this is an electric pulley system here. So downer animals can be down because of fractures or joint luxations, could be sick because of sepsis and shock, or they could have electrolyte imbalances. They could be low on calcium or potassium. So we can use hip lifters or slings. We even float them in big tubs in order to keep them off their limbs. Other things that can happen, dog or wild animal attacks, especially with sheep and goats. We worry about blood loss, contaminated wounds, and rabies concerns. So those are all things that we need to worry about with large animals. And I believe we have, here we go. Dystocia and obstetrical emergencies. So we see a lot of problems with animals that are having trouble giving birth. So we want to do a rectal and vaginal exam, maybe do an epidural for these guys so that we can relax them and make it less painful. We may need to do vaginal or C-section delivery with small ruminant dystocias. You have to have smaller hands because they do have an increased risk of rupturing the uterus. Uterine torsion happens with cattle and camelids, where if they have a violent birth or a large animal or calf that comes out, their uterus may flip on them. And that is just as bad as having a stomach torsion. It can really damage blood vessels and cause death within the, it caused death in the animal because it kills tissue in the animal. We correct this with a plank in the flank procedure, which is really interesting. I'm going to mute that for you. What they're doing is they have an animal down on its side, and they have a plank, and they put the plank up. And it's not showing, it just went too far. So what they do is they put the plank on the animal, have somebody stand on the plank. It's going to go too fast. And then they turn the animal with the plank in place. When they turn the animal with a plank in place, the plank holds the uterus in place and turns the animal around the uterus. So it fixes that torsion. It's actually done here in the United States as well. Uterine prolapses are pretty common. Again, if we have a large calf, then they're pushing really hard to get the calf or the young out of the fetus out. The uterus sometimes comes out as well, so we need to replace that if we can. Toxic metritis or mastitis is we have infections in the mammary glands or within the uterus. Metritis means uterus. Something really common in small animals, small ruminants, males in small ruminants, sheep and goats, especially castrated males, tend to get stones. And the reason is that they are fed, if they're fed too much grain and have decreased access to water, these crystals form from the grain and it forms into calculi really easily. If you see this calculi, this is in a goat, you can see this little these little beads here, the little string of beads. The problem is that this urethra has a sigmoid flexure, which means that it goes in this little thing. We cannot just catheterize this animal because we can't make a catheter do that. So often we have to do surgery to relieve that. So this can be a death sentence. Feeding too much grain to your really cute little goat that has been castrated could be a death sentence. When you are in large animal, you will want to have a dystocia box and equipment because that will happen in the springtime and you want to be ready to go. You want sterile sleeves, sterile lubricants, sterile obstetric chains, a calf jack, a fetotome if you have a dead fetus, a cray hook, eye hooks, finger knife, bucket, pump, and uterine lavage tube. Those are all essentials for your dystocia box. And that's all I've got on emergency and critical care. Take a look at this again. Ask me any questions you have. Thanks for listening.